I think it's in both Boca and Jupiter.
Oh.
So
can you take cameras if you see Dr. Locke here?
No, that's good.
Okay.
Oh.
Can you hear us? Oh, we see him. Okay.
Okay, good.
Okay. We see both of you. Okay. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Florida Woman in Mass Day 2022. So I'm glad that we can come here, even though the COVID situation happened here, but I'm glad that we can organize this kind of the event. So welcome you. And here we have a special guest today, Dr. Stephen Locke, here chair of our March department. He will have a few words to you guys.
Okay, good morning. Happy to see everybody here. You can hear me well enough? Okay, so I'm looking at the program here, and looks like you're going to have a fun day. You've got some research talks to listen to. You've got some keynote speakers, and you've got a career panel. So hopefully that will all be interesting and that you like doing that. I'm very happy to see that three of our graduate students are giving talks today. That's very nice that we've got students participating to that level. And I say I'm very happy to see that going on. I'll let you know that our department is hopefully going to grow this year, because I've just made offers to two people in cryptography. So hopefully they'll both accept, and then we'll have a couple of extra people here. And one thing that I've kind of noticed as I'm talking to people is that some people have been through programs where they spend some time counseling them how to negotiate a job offer. And I don't know that we do that. And so I'm going to suggest right now that maybe our department consider doing that, so that when our students are looking for jobs, they have a little bit of an idea what they can do to negotiate perhaps a slightly better salary or a better startup package, those types of things. So it might be good if we would put something like that into place for our graduate students as well. We spend time training them how to teach in the classroom, but it would be nice maybe to teach them how to at least survive through the next stage of their education. So other than that little editorializing, I wish you all a happy day here, that everything goes well, and I'll be back around 1 o'clock or so, and to see the rest of the proceedings here. Okay. So good luck and have fun.
Thank you, Dr. Locke. So the research session will start in the next 5 minutes. So let me show the schedule.
Did have a session.
So today we will have a six talks. Three person will talk. We have a speak in FAU, and three person will have a speak on. We have a talk online. So I hope you guys are gonna enjoy it, and the other of the talks we will place it on our website. You guys can go and check it, or you can check it on our program. Archana, can you please come here to prepare for the talk?
So this is my presentation deck.
Yes.
Oh yeah, thank you. So sometimes you choose something useful.
It
about dynamics and optimal control of HIV infection and opioid addiction.
Is it muted?
You say something. I said it. I just unmute. It needs unmute.
Is listening? Is it listening?
Can you guys hear us?
From Zoom, ask Jeannie if she could hear.
I can hear you just fine.
Okay, thank you. Let me check my. Can you see us from here? Okay, sorry.
Thank you very much, Tran, Yuganti, and all of here for giving me this opportunity of presentation. I'm Archana Leopanithimsina, and I'm a PhD candidate in this Florida Atlantic University Mathematics Department. And I'm also Vice President of FAU, AWM FAU chapter. Now I'm going to present in the title, Dynamics and Optimal Control of HIV and Opioid Epidemics. So this is my one of the work during my PhD study here. And my advisor of this work is Dr. Najibe Junchar. Actually, we all know about the HIV, and we all know one of the main reasons to transfer HIV is needle sharing. And you know, the if the people uses the drugs means opioid, then they have some temptation, and then they don't think that they are sharing the needles, means they are so in rush that to take the drugs, and then they share the needle. And you know, the HIV is can be transmitted through the by sharing the needles. And if any non-HIV infected people and HIV infected people share the needle, then there may be the chances of spreading of the HIV virus. So that is from the CDC. So taking those point, we develop a model about HIV and opioid addiction. And in this work, actually, we study about the equilibrium point of the infection and the opioid. We found out the reproduction numbers, invasion number, and the stability. And then in this study, we also find out the parameters while doing the study of the model. We need a lots of parameters, and we estimate the parameter using least square methods, available data from CDC. And once we estimate the parameters, that wouldn't be truthful. Sometimes means, you know, we have to use those parameters, and then we have to analyze and check lots of other concern and related results using those parameters, so that we have to check the identifiability of the parameters also. So we did it. And then later we applied four controls in the model and analyze what would be the effect of the controls in that model. So all of those analyses we did through the numerical way. So those are my outline of my presentation. And you know, so we consider N is a whole big population, and we split the population into six compartment. The S is the susceptible, that means those group of people who can be infected, that is called susceptible. And then the second one is the addicted individual group of people, that is you. V is the HIV infected people, and I1 is the addicted individuals who are
first stage of HIV infection. It is considered that the when HIV virus invade into the body of the of any person, then it will show its first 15 days. It will show its some activity, and later it would go in kind of a quiet nature. So that's why this I1 is the first stage infection. I2 is the second stage infection. And then once the virus attacks into the anybody's, any people's bodies, any person's bodies, then it wouldn't get out from there. So it would stay there and would be in the AIDS form. So we check AIDS is the last developed form of the HIV virus in my model. And you know, this is the susceptible people, and some of they go into the addicted form, and some of they go into the infected form, and then addicted and infected come into interaction with each other and get into I1 means the first stage, and then I2 into the second stage, and at the end, the AIDS stage. So this is, you know, the dynamics of virus and opioid in some population, and those are the description of the variables and parameters I used in this analysis. And now, so by considering, we made this model. So this is OD, everything in this model you can see here. And now, so then, I'm sorry. So what, how can I remove this one? I want to show the topics. No. It's okay now. Now it's okay now. I go from here. Close out. It's okay. This is the I did already did this one, and this is the model. So then in my, from the point is the point where there is no activity of the thing. So there is no activity of the virus. The ODE model, this model is actually the most dynamics and opioid. So if we consider there is, that means the derivative parts, those all parts are zero, right? If there is no activities, then derivative is constant, right? So means you know the zero, derivatives of the constant is zero. So then we do the left side is zero, and then find out the equilibrium point. So we consider two. Of virus, and there is no presence of opioid. By considering this situation, equilibrium point, and then find out the is actually the number of secondary infections produced one infected individual. Susceptible population during its lifetime infection. So we found out the basic reproduction number, and we found invasion reproduction number. Invasion reproduction number. Let us say that there is no presence of any opioid, only the presence of HIV. So how, what would be the invasion of the opioid? We consider that the, let us say that HIV, only the presence of opioid, then how the number of invasion of the opioid in that condition. So, and so those number here, the while doing the disease-free equilibrium point, those R0 is the, this R0 is the basic reproduction number. We find our work, and we found out the invasion number also during our analysis, and we developed a theorem and proved this theorem also. And this is the HIV only equilibrium point. I already told you that. So we consider those things. only the presence of HIV and prove this theorem. The other one is okay. So do of the model, considering three conditions, no digits, no 0.1 HIV, and the other one is 0.1. So, and we studied equilibrium point, we studied invasion numbers, and stability, all of those. After that, we consider that, okay, let us suppose we apply the four control in the, what would be the effect of the control? As those things that U1 is the control we applied there, if we treat the addicted people, how would be the result of the number of the individuals there? And if we applied education and rehabilitation for addicted people, what would be that? That we take U2, and if we apply heart means there is a therapy for the HIV infected and HIV AIDS people, and what would be the effect of that control? And if we apply the recover for the addiction for those HIV infected people, and what would be the effect? So as a whole, we apply four control in our model and then study what would be the effect after that numerically. So then those are the controls we applied in the model. You can see the red letters in the model. That means that we applied the controls in this form. So and U4, we applied in the form of U1 only, and 1 minus U2, and the other one is 1 minus U3, we apply in this form. We can apply in our necessary there, but we have to be careful about the their boundaries in that case. So once we apply the those controls in the model, then we developed a cost functions, you know, that we have to study, so what would be the, so that we are finding out the results from this objective functional, and this is actually the optimal control theory we use to study what would be the effect of some control. In that optimal theory, we can make a set of optimal control problem in this way. So in this optimal problem, there exists there should be a functional, so which we use, which we have to check out the cost of this function. Would that be, which we are going to minimize this function in this dynamics? Okay, so then this is called optimal control theory. So we use the optimal control theory to study this kind of analysis, and so we did the existence. So first of all, okay, we said, but we have to check whether the setup is existed or not. So we check the existence of the setup by using this Fallopian-Cesari theorem. And this is very simple. You know, we can check this existence by using our undergraduate knowledge analysis, algebra knowledge only. So then we check all of those. And then in our model, existed, and you know, so after existence, we use maximum principle. So this is very renowned Pontryagin maximum principle. So once the optimal setup is existed, then we can make the necessary condition from the setup to make algorithms to do the analysis of those things. And this is also, this is the maximum principle we use, and then make the conditions from there. Then those are the conditions we found out from the maximum principle. So this is optimality condition. You If we are going to find out some max or mean, we do the derivative equal to zero, right? This is undergraduate knowledge. So we use that knowledge, so equal to zero. And then we found out those conditions. We already had the one dynamics motion. And then we make a adjoint equation and then the transversality condition. Okay, so then we make the algorithms using forward and backward swept methods. And then I want to do first. So then, and then we check the identity using the those structural identifiability and practical identifiability concept. Because why? This is because why? So we are using so many parameters, and we have to check the parameters identifiability. You know, if we do the inverse of the function, do that give us the one-to-one result or not? Means one input and one output, kind of those things. So we use those things. Those are also very simple. And then in our curve fitting. So curve fitting, we use the square method. So we use this data and find out the parameters. And those are the fitted parameters we found out and get the parameters from there. We check all of those things. So if you wanted to know more elaborate, any times other day, so then we found out this result. So this is the result. You can see here that when we applied those controls in our model, you can see that with controls, the avoid addicted with controls is low, right? Without controls, high. And here the infected is also low with controls. I2 is also low. And without controls, they are high. But here you can see just reverse. You know, so HIV and AIDS position, we take that the people consider that if got the HIV, then they die. That is not true. So if there is some control, they can extend their time. So by considering these two things, this is the extension of life so that they can live better life if they use the control. So this is the result I found out. Saying thank you very much. So I use this references. So if you have any question, you can ask me.
Thank you very much, Archana. If you have any question for Archana, please ask after the
session.
One word
to
question.
Because
I took long time,
right? Yeah. Perhaps we should skip the question session, go to the next one. You have questions
asked. We will continue the question after the session.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Our next speaker is Sulan Shira from FAU. Her topic is cryptology.
Thank you.
So good morning, everyone. So thank you for the introduction and giving me this opportunity to talk in the AWM conference. So I am Sunan Takshila, yes. And I'm a graduate student from Florida Atlantic University. Today I'm talking about homomorphic encryption. So this is my outline. First, I will briefly give introduction about cryptology and the homotopic encryption and related theory and its applications. So cryptology. Cryptology is a study of techniques that communicating between two or many parties in a secure manner. So cryptology has two aspects, mainly symmetric key cryptography and asymmetric key cryptography, which is the public key cryptography. So symmetric key cryptography using a single key, secret key, to encrypt and decrypt the message. So, and asymmetric key cryptography, public key cryptography using two different keys, which is encrypted using a public key and decrypt using the receiver's secret key. Here I use the Seth and Ron. So Seth send a message to Ron. So Ron using his Seth using Ron's public key and Ron's using his secret key for the decrypt. So we have some advantages and disadvantages of symmetric key and asymmetric key cryptography. So advantages of symmetric key cryptography: relatively fast and secure, and adoption and acceptance is there. And disadvantages is that because it's a single key uses, so sharing key is somewhat like not secure some sense. And also if the secret key is revealed, then more damage will be there. And asymmetric key cryptography, no need to exchange the keys, and increased security is there. And disadvantages is that it's low speed. And
can you speak louder?
To the speaker.
Yeah.
To a sweet speaker.
Yeah.
Closer to the speaker for
yeah.
Zoom people.
Okay, thank you.
So disadvantages is that it's low speed because complex algorithms and long key lengths. So homomorphic encryption, this is the what I'm talking about today. So homomorphic encryption is an encryption method that use public key for encrypt, and decryption can be done using the private key, who has the private key after all the computation on encrypted data. And the purpose of homomorphic encryption is the main importance is there. Its computation we can be done on ciphertext or encrypted data. So this is the the process how we are doing the homomorphic encryption is mainly. So in the client side, if you want to send a message from client to server, and then getting back the output. So send a message. First we encode that one and then encrypt, and then server doing some computations on encrypted data, something like addition, multiplication, linearization, rotations we can do. Then server send back a computation on encrypted data, and decrypt we can do by secret key, and then decode the text we want to have. So then we have mainly three kind of homomorphic encryption. First one is partial homomorphic encryption. So partial homomorphic encryption using we can use one operation on ciphertext. Somewhat homomorphic encryption uses greater number of operations on ciphertext. Fully homomorphic, which is the most important one, we can do arbitrary operations on the ciphertext. So related theory. So as we know, the homomorphic mean is a homomorphism. I believe most of people in here know what is a homomorphism. So homomorphism is a map from one group to another group that preserve the operation. So here the XY coming from group G and PXPY is coming from H group. So we can extend this the homotopy structure. So to rings or algebraic objects, we can extend that one. In cryptology, we using a randomized function to encrypt the message, and we use the decrypted function, which is many to one function, and also inverse of the encryption function. So encryption function, when we using the encryption, the encryption and decryption function to homomorphism. So if we have two messages, M1, M2, we can, this is the first level in homomorphism. So we have the product of encrypted message M1 and M2 and decrypted, we can get the original product of the message M1, M2. And additive and multiplication is the same. If we encrypt two messages, summation or product, we can, it has the same meaning of the encrypt of M1, M2 message originally. So applications. So here, there are so many applications in the homomorphic encryption nowadays. So I briefly explain about Microsoft SEAL 2.3.1 library. It's very highly used. They used this technology highly used the homomorphic encryption. How they apply the application is that the reduction is done by the first notation is mod t, and the next notation is rounding down and rounding up and nearest to the integer. So our plain text space is quotient ring RT, and when n is the more power of 2. Ciphertext is RQ modded by Q. Q is a multiple of prime numbers, and secret key is coming from R2. Here R by 2, it is just a pair, like a coordinate. And then public key is a pair where A coming from RQ and E coming from chi distribution. And evaluation key we using for the mainly product of the two ciphertext. So because when we multiply in two ciphertext, its length of the ciphertext become increased. So it is not good for our computation. So we reduce the length of the ciphertext by evaluation keys. So this is the pair of the evaluation key for the length M, and we can reduce the ciphertext length M by time to time until we that we want. So I explain only encryption and decryption. There is a lot of theory in there. So encryption of a plain text message M is we can use public key P0 P1, and ciphertext is a pair C0 C1. C0 is the formula. I can explain, and decryption is a length of ciphertext 2. Yes, okay. Decryption is a number, one number we can get this formula. So this is all about my presentation. Thanks for listening. And these are my references.
Do you have any question for Solani?
Yes.
So you present on homomorphic crypto systems. Is this the most common crypto system used currently?
Yes, Microsoft SEAL. SEAL, they're using homomorphic encryption, and not only the Microsoft SEAL, we can use some election security and cloud computing, because the whole, I said, like fully homomorphic encryption is highly useful in cloud computing.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next speaker, he will be talking about computation of subsystem homology using Bilani list filtration.
Good. Can everybody hear me online? You good?
Yes.
Everybody can hear me? Good. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome.
All is good here.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. My name is Amish Mishra. I am presenting on topological data analysis with Delaney Rips, introducing an efficient method for TDA. One more thing. Sorry, I just had to turn on the laser pointer. All right, now there's a button here that lets me. Okay, cool. Don't worry about what these words mean. We're going to get into it little by little. But first, we're going to begin with an overview. So my presentation will have four sections. It'll have an introduction, and then I'll talk about the standard approach in this field, describing what it is, our approach, and then the conclusion. So we begin with this example called the data source dozen. And this is an example given to statistics students to show them why it's so important to plot your data. If you can see in this slide, we start with the data set that looks like a dinosaur, and we see that its standard statistics, the X mean, the Y mean, the standard deviation on the X axis, the standard deviation on the Y axis, and the correlation coefficient is as follows. And what happens now is we take this dinosaur data set and we scramble it to look like these 12 other data sets. Now, the interesting thing is we have kept the same standard statistics when we scramble this data. So everything in this box applies to each of these data sets, which should be kind of shocking, like up to two decimal places. If you just look at the basic statistics for a data set, they all look the same in terms of the numbers. But are these data sets the same? Of course they're not. They look different when you plot them. You see that one looks like a circle, one looks like a cluster of 9 points, one looks like an X, one looks like a random data set, and of course, one looks like a dinosaur. The only way you can tell the difference between these data sets, or one of the best ways, is if you can plot it and you can actually see the shape. And so this is why we encourage statistics students, don't just trust the statistics. Don't just run the numbers and then just trust that you have the full picture, because you need to be able to graph it. But now, obviously, we have a problem. And the problem is, what if visualization is not an option? Why would visualization not be an option? Well, any mathematics student that has stayed in the field for more than maybe a year has recognized that eventually math works in higher dimensions. We start dealing with dimensions in 4, 5, 6 dimension space. And now, can you plot your data in dimension 7 and visualize it? No, it's very difficult. And so what do? This is where we have a solution called TDA. TDA stands for topological data analysis. What topological data analysis helps us do is quantify the shape-based features of data for computation and statistical analysis. An application of TDA is in brain arteries. So here's an image from a paper published where they took a bunch of CT scans of different brains and they plotted their brain arteries. And what they found was the more looping there was in brain arteries, it corresponded to a younger brain. And TDA helped to quantify how much are the brain arteries looping. If they're looping a lot, that means the brain was a much younger brain from an individual in their teens or their 20s. When the arteries were looping less, that meant that they got the scan from a brain that was much older. And this is something able to be done using the power of TDA. Here's the pipeline for how this field, at least the research that I do, works. You start with a data set, like over there. Now, obviously, you can look at this data set and you can decide, what does it look like? What does the data set look like? Looks like a circle. It looks like it's got a loop in it. But now that's what a human brain can do. We're really good at doing that. If we want a computer to be able to do this for us, and then be able to do this for us in higher dimensions, we need a computer to be able to visualize the data for itself. This is a very common problem in computer science. How can a computer do what a human can do? And so what we do is we build something called a complex on the data. And this is a way to connect the points that's meaningful for the computer. And then the computer is able to tell us the information we need from this diagram. I'll explain what this diagram is in a little bit. It's called the persistence diagram. Just know that that is what we're after. And there is a lot that happens between this step and this step. There's a lot of math that goes into it. But the nice thing about TDA is you don't completely have to understand the math to be able to use this sort of application in this sort of field to work in. The next thing you get is an interpretation. So from this diagram, I'm able to read it and tell you there's one significant loop in the data. And hopefully by the end of the presentation, you will be as well. That wraps up the introduction. Now we'll go into the standard approach that's done in this field. So instead of explaining what it is, I'm just going to show you an animation. Here's a bunch of data, maybe 20, 25 points. And what the computer is going to do, it's going to start expanding these bubbles or these balls around every single point. When these balls start overlapping, it's going to start making connections with their centers. So as you can see, as these balls start expanding, when they start overlapping, it starts connecting the centers up. And so by the end of this animation, you just have everything connected to everything. All the points are connected to each other. Now, what was the point of doing this? This is called RIPS. And what RIPS does is that along the way of constructing these connections, it has found, in some sense, the golden radius, the golden point at which, when we expanded the balls, we had a loop in our data that the computer actually saw, hey, our data actually looks like a circle. And that happened at radius 4.442. So each of these blue balls has a radius of 0.442. That is when the circle was formed. At radius 0.884, when the balls got big enough, then our hole died. After that, we have our RIPS persistence diagram. And this diagram actually shows us the birth, when the hole was born, and the death, when it died. So this orange circle is what corresponds to this hole in our data set. Now, what we want to do as researchers in this field is reduce the number of connections, because right now there's so many connections, it takes a long time to run. So what we're going to do is build a new approach, and we're going to call it the Delaunay-RIPS method. This method looks very similar to the earlier one, but in this one, we're going to connect points so that we make, in some sense, the prettiest triangles out of our data. It's a very similar approach as we did before, but what we've done is make sure that we're not connecting points across a bunch of triangles. And so we see that we get the same information out. Remember, this diagram tells us everything we need to know about the data set. We get the same information out for a lot less of the cost. So notice RIPS is on the left side, Delaunay-RIPS is on the right side. They look identical. This means that we're getting the same information from our data using this computer method. And look at the difference in the computation. RIPS had to connect all these points to get to the conclusion it did, whereas our method is only connecting a fraction of those points. Here's a runtime comparison on a sphere. So we got points in three-dimensional space now, and we're just going to keep adding more points to this sphere and see what happens. As we add more and more points, that's on the x-axis, we can see three of the methods running: RIPS, alpha, and Delaunay-RIPS. So RIPS is what I introduced in this presentation. Alpha is another method that I did not get to in this presentation. And then Delaunay-RIPS is ours. We can see that the y-axis is the time that it took to run. And RIPS is already slowing down. It's running for 5 seconds on 350 points, whereas our method can go into thousands of points and run in under a second. This is a significant speed up. And so in conclusion, what do? We showcase the RIPS method for TDA. We developed the Delaunay-RIPS complex conceptually. I implemented it algorithmically so I can show you these animations. And then in future work, we want to use this to classify data sets. So we're going to do this on synthetic data sets. And then we want to apply it to real data to prove to people that you actually really want to use this method. It's faster, it's better, it gets you the same information. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge my advisor, Dr. Francis Mata, for giving me a light hand in this work and giving me guidance along the way. The FE Mathematics Department, and particularly AWM, for giving me the opportunity to speak this morning. My family, for their encouragement and their prayers along the way. It's very difficult to do a PhD and stay in it by yourself. And my Lord and Savior, who has said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength." I believe when Jesus says you're to love the Lord with your mind, it means to use your mind for what it has been gifted for. And I believe that's been to add value to this field called TDA. Here are my references, and I will be happy to take your questions. Any questions? Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Amish. Also, Maya Agi, University of Florida.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Maya, and today I'm going to talk about an unconstrained optimization approach to singular control problem. And I did this work with, it's a joint work with Dr. William Hager at the University of Florida. Let's begin with what is control theory. So in control theory, we always begin with some dynamical system that you can see here, which can have variety of form from ordinary differential equation, partial differential equation, or even a stochastic differential equation. But in this presentation, we just focus on ordinary differential equation. And our dynamics represent our state that we are interested to tracking or changing. And we entered the control into our dynamics to affect our dynamics and change the output. So the goal of our optimal control problem is to find the control function, which most of the time is a piecewise continuous function, which these u with the corresponding trajectory x, together they can minimize our cost, which we showed here by C. And most of the time we have some constraint on control. So our control takes value from admissible set of control that we showed here by script U. For our numerical methods, we need some starting guess. So we always discretize the problem by using some forward Euler's method. And then we solve the discrete problem by using some optimization solver, which here, the optimization solver we use is PASA, polyhedral active set algorithm, which you can have a free access from Dr. William Hager's website. And most of the time, this kind of optimal control problem can be reduced as an optimization problem over switching point. Switching point is when the control change their structure. For example, if it's a constant, which most of the time is called bank, and change it to the some singular control, and these changes, when it's changed, the time is switching times, and it arises discontinuity to our problem. And we try to optimize our control over these switching times. So if the control is just pure bang-bang, it means it's just pure piecewise constant, this process is just takes some few iterations. But if we have some singular control, then it takes more time. So let us start with some example. Dr. Nedzevich, Eshkalder, and I, we were working on an SIR epidemiological model that we divide the population in three different classes, susceptible, S, infected, I, and recovered, R. And we wanted to incorporate two different control, vaccination U, and treatment V, that to minimize the number of infectious individuals, and at the same time, we wanted to minimize the cost of vaccination and treatment. As you can see, this is our cost function that we defined, and this is our dynamics. And here, all of the Greek letters are just constant parameter, and our controls U and V is our focus to optimize. So we wanted to find some approximation solution and from the process that we just discussed. So the control V bang, the just piecewise constant, we can have it here, but the control U has a singular arc, which in singular region, the control oscillates between upper and lower bound. This oscillation is not desired and it's unwanted, and we need to remove it from our approximation solution. One of the well-known methods to remove this oscillation is the method that Jacobson proposed, and in mathematical literature is called the proximal technique. Is we can add a strongly convex term to our cost function and then solve the problem. This term makes our singular problem to non-singular problem, and then we can solve the problem. But finding a right epsilon here is a delicate issue. So we suggested that to use some regularization method based on total variation regularization. So we add a total variation term to our objective functional, and then we can solve the problem. But we want to use some gradient-based algorithm, so we want our cost function to be differentiable. But you can see that here we have absolute value, which makes our cost function non-smooth. So we need to fix this problem. We suggested that by introducing two new variables, R and Z, we can convert non-smooth problem to the smooth problem. And by adding a constraint for our problem, which you can see here. So now our cost is differentiable, and we can solve our problem to see the solution. Here you can see when we change the rho, our penalty term for regularization, when rho is 10 to the power negative 8, still we have the oscillation, but when rho equals 10 to the power negative 3, most of oscillation is gone, and we have just big jumps around switching points. And when rho equals 10 to the power negative 2, we can say that we have almost smooth singular arc in our solution. So now we have our approximate solution, which we use as a starting guess. So we propose the switch point algorithm, which can solve non-smooth problem. This non-smooth can arise from the discontinuity in switching times that we talk about, or it can arise from singular control. And here, we show the switching times by SI, I from 1 to K, and we want to optimize our solution over these switching times. Also, we need the equation for singular control that we use some well-known method by differentiating the switching function. In our algorithm, we focus on two separate cases, which depends on the function of singular control. If the function of singular control just depends on X, we have a feedback form of the function of singular control here. Then we say case one, and if the function of singular control depends on both state and co-state, we have case two. And then we can use the gradient-based optimization to find the optimal control solution. We can just talk about case one here. So In case one, the control depends on just a state variable in singular region, because in other region, we just have a constant control. So we just need to focus on the singular region, which the control is not constant. And then after substitution of the control function in our dynamics in singular region, so our dynamic has these form. Now we can minimize the cost with respect to switching function. So after applying this process, our algorithm, we can see that the optimal control was effective. Because if we don't use any control, means if we don't use any vaccination or treatment that is in the red figure, you can see that the number of susceptible people are decreasing, but all of them are adding to the number of infectious people. And we can say that no individual can recover from the disease. However, after using the control and the method, we can say that the number of susceptible people are decreasing most of the times, and all of them are adding to the recovered individuals, and the number of infected individuals is around 23, which is something we want. So we can control the epidemic by using the vaccination and treatment. The data we use for numerical experiment here is from the South Africa and from the outbreak of Ebola in 2014. Thank you. And if you have any question, I would be happy to answer.
I have a question.
Hi.
Can we extend this model for the COVID? And if it is so, what are the parameters we have to consider?
So some of the papers, for example, one of the paper in Elsevier, they are, at first they considered SIR model for COVID-19, but because the COVID is different from Ebola, because they have a class E that they are exposed, but they are not infected. So they need to add the one more component, the E, that the individual that are exposed and not recovered. But if we want to model the COVID more precisely, we need to add another component, because, for example, for SIR model, we consider that after recovered, they don't come back to the susceptible people, but in COVID-19, they can get the COVID again. So we need to add this class also.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And sorry, I need to add one more comment. So also we can add a Q, which is for quarantine, that it's after recovered, they are in the class of quarantine. So it would be more precise if we can add that class too.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maya. Thank you very much, Maya. Our next speaker is Shiranim Pereira. She will be talking about fast factor-based low complexity discrete sign transformation algorithm.
Can you say yes, Shri?
Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk about the sparse factors-based low complexity algorithm for the discrete sign transform. This was funded by the Faculty Innovative Research in Science and Technology grant at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. And this is also a joint work with one of my students, Levi Lynch, and who is the graduate student in a computational engineering field in ETH Zurich. So thank you for inviting me. And we're going to talk about a little background behind the discrete sine transform and also the discrete cosine and discrete Fourier transform. And after that, we're going to talk about some sparse and orthogonal factors of the proposed transform. Once the factorizations are proposed, we're going to derive the low complexity algorithm. And then after that, we're going to see some application in the signal processing and also the image encryption. In 1965, FFT algorithm was derived by Cooley and Tuckey to analyze the rotation of the helium-3 molecule. Since then, till today, it's dramatically and significantly used in many applications, including solving PDEs and polynomial multiplication, image compression, image restorations, and fingerprint analysis, and video compression, so on and so forth. So FFT is fast Fourier transform, is the algorithm that can be used to compute the discrete Fourier transform, which is a matrix, and its inverse efficiently. In this discrete Fourier transform, matrix has two variants. One is the real variant, the other one is an imaginary variant. So in the real part, we call the discrete cosine transform. In the imaginary part, we call the discrete sine transform. And all these variants has, like discrete cosine transform has 8 variants, and so has the discrete sine transform. But we discuss very often on discrete cosine transform from 1 to 4, whereas you could see through the superscript, and then discrete sine transform from 1 to 4 as well. And this transform was introduced around 1970s, including electrical engineers. Most of them are electrical engineers, not the mathematicians though. The Rao, Chen, Smith, Frank, Chen, Kakre, and Solanke. And then the subscript is to denote the size of the each transformation matrices. And these are some historical results behind the discrete cosine transform and discrete sine transform. And in here, we have a Chen, Smith, and Frank in 1977, and he derived the FAST algorithm, but those algorithms are not recursive. But in those algorithms, he had orthogonal factors. When we derive the FAST algorithm for the discrete cosine or discrete sine, we can mainly use two approaches. One is the polynomial multiplication technique, the other one is the matrix factorization technique. In the polynomial multiplication technique, what we do is we take these transformation matrices, hit with a vector so that we will get an n component. So we construct the degree n polynomial, and then we use a divide and conquer technique to reduce the degree of the polynomial. The matrix factorization technique, as it says, we take the matrix. We take the matrix and we factor it into the product of sparse factors. So both methods, by using both methods, we can derive FAST algorithm. So in here, Olszewski's paper, this is quite different than the polynomial multiplication and a matrix factorization technique. They use the polynomial division based on the matrix factorization. And here they have, these papers are based on the matrix factorization. This is Plonk and Tasha, again, is based on the matrix factorization. This is Strang, and he is the one, he mentioned about this, the relationship between the columns of the matrices to the eigenvalues of the second difference equation. And then the Valdivia, Yip, and Rao, they use a similar approach to extend Strang's results from discrete cosine transform into the discrete sine transform. And then Puschel and Maurer, they use the polynomial arithmetic technique to factor these matrices. And these are some of the work that I have done with my collaborators and students. And we were able to derive the algorithm that are fast and recursive and orthogonal and stable algorithm as well. And then we discuss some application in the signal processing. And in these papers, this papers has results based on the lowest complexity discrete cosine transform algorithm. And what we're going to talk today is we're going to talk about the lowest complexity discrete sine transform algorithm and their applications as well. So what we did first is in Olszewski's paper, he used the paper by Gilbert Schrank, who is an MIT professor. And then what he did was he took this transformation and he factored into the product of matrices. One is a weight matrix, the other one is a van der Monde matrix. And then further on, they factored the van der Monde matrix into the product of matrices, whereas it has a permutation matrix, an odd even matrix, and another sparse matrix. What we did in our paper, we took those van der Monde matrix and also the weight matrix, we further factored into the product of matrices, and we put these, the weight matrix and the van der Monde matrix as like a even, with the even sizes, and then we derive this factorization. So in here, like you could see, these matrices are highly sparse matrices. You can see that all the empty spaces are the one that represent zeros in it. These are the identity matrices. These are the anti-diagonal matrix. This matrix W is also a diagonal matrix, whereas you will see a lot of zeros in it. And so the key, one of the key thing is to derive the low complexity algorithm is if you take the matrix and if you factor it into the sparse matrices, that will help you to reduce the complexity of the algorithm. And we do the same for the discrete sine transform. So we are the Olszewski and Kaila, they use the Strength paper and we use their paper to further decompose into the product of matrices so that this will has like a transformation matrix. It depends on the half of itself. So every iteration, it goes to the half of the original size, having highly sparse matrix. Like you could see, this is a bidiagonal matrix. And then most entries are zero. And even the non-zero entries, we have a ones. And then this is the one non-unit non-zero entry. So the multiplication is drastically reduced. Oh, 2 minutes left. Okay. And then we have the, thanks, Shan. So we have the cosine transform as well. And then and then not only that, we were able to find the relationship between these transformation, which was a missing part in the literature. And then the nice thing about it, you can relate this transformation by using highly sparse matrices, whereas these blue guys are diagonal matrices, whereas the red guys are bidiagonal matrices. So we can nicely, beautifully connect those things. This is what in the history had. So every transform is depend on the other transform according to our factorization. It's not like this transform depend on the other or depend on the other. They depend on itself and they can recursively execute with each other. And then look at how simple the algorithm is. And these are very easy to implement so that it takes, I mean, it takes like a couple of lines to execute this algorithm. And then you can clearly see the recursive pattern in here. And then these are the explicit complexity of the algorithm that you could see. And based on that, our algorithms attain the lowest multiplication complexity in the literature. that's quite impressive. And then we were able to draw the signal flow graph based on those algorithms. So it requires, say, for example, if it is an 8-point, so it usually need 8, 8, 16 multiplication. In each row you have 8 multiplication, 7 addition. So then when you go like 8 by 8, 8 times 8 is, you need 64 multiplication, whereas instead of 64, we only use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, opposed to the 64, which is quite nice handy saving when you compute, I mean, when you talk about the engineering point of view, which is quite expensive in that sense. And we were able to analyze the encryption scheme based on the proposed algorithm. And then we took 256 by 256 image. This is the red, green, and blue channel histogram. And if you discretize this image, I mean, if you take any image, when you discretize it, so it can be considered as a matrix. So in here, you can see that in the encryption, it's nice, beautiful encryption. You can't like distinguish this channel. This, once you use a discrete Fourier transform without using the proposed algorithm, you can see that these channels will start to show up. So it did not encrypt properly. So what we were able to do is we were able to increase the encryption performance, even having the chaotic motion in those images. And we talk about these properties, and I have limited time, and I already overran the time. I'm sorry for that. And we have the published paper based on the algorithm. So it's published in the IEEE Access. So if you're interested, you can read it and feel free to ask any question. Again, thank you for inviting. I appreciate.
Thank you, Sirande, so much for that. Running out of time, so if anyone has questions, they contact Sirande or email her later. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sirande. Our last speaker is Sumati Pareja from Vanderbilt University.
Hello, everyone. Just give me one sec. Let me start my screen sharing. Okay, so can you all see my screen? And can you hear me? Okay. Hi, everyone. Good morning. First of all, thank you for giving me this nice opportunity. So today we are going to talk about transport transforms for machine learning. And the work that I'm going to present here is done in collaboration with Professor Akram Al-Robi, Professor Gustavo Rode, Dr. Yvonne Medri, and Dr. Rocio Diaz-Martin. So as the name suggests, I'm talking about some transform in one dimension. So like most of the transforms that we have seen, especially on for functions in R, are linear transforms. But as we have come across this new field of data analysis and data science, we are seeing more and more non-linearity appearing in our problems. And as a small contribution to the field of non-linear transforms on real line, we have this transport transform. The idea basically comes up from this transport theory, which is a very old theory proposed in 1700s by Monge. And what does it want you to do is, it wants you to transport mass from one location to the other in the most optimal way, right? And the transport transform basically encodes that optimal transport map that you're looking for to transport mass from one position to the other. So yeah, when we are talking about masses, so we have to talk about measures. So for that, we have what we call as the cumulative distribution transform, which basically works for probability measures. So given a source measure mu, the CDT of a target measure mu with respect to mu is a non-decreasing function represented by this nice expression from R to R, R bar to R bar, represented by this nice expression where F mu and F nu are the respective CDFs, hence the name cumulative distribution transform. Just to recall that F mu of X is mu of this set, right? And F nu dagger, F dagger is a generalized inverse that we have for technicality of the things. But like I said, we are talking about probability measures, but probability measures have certain restrictions. First of all, that the mass, total mass of every measure would be one, and the measure should be non-negative. But since we are mathematicians, we wanted to generalize this to, you know, more stuff. Why just talk about only one category of measures? Why not talk about all category of measures? And for that, we have what we now call as the sine cumulative distribution transform. And we basically utilize the Jordan decomposition of a sine, of an arbitrary sine measure. And so Jordan decomposition basically breaks the measure into two positive parts two non-negative parts, sorry. And we work on each non-negative part separately. So, transform of the first new plus is basically given by this expression, and transform of the new negative is given by this expression, where new plus star is this same map, but with the normalized measure. So basically you are kind of making your measure, the new plus measure, which has an arbitrary mass, into a probability measure, and then giving out its optimal transport map, which was given by CDT. And finally, you're keeping the track of this normalization by keeping this into your four-dimensional vector space. So the transform here is a four-dimensional vector that consists of two non-decreasing functions and two real numbers. And like we know that transform basically takes data from one place to the other where it is easy to work with. But the main important point is that you should be able to bring back your whatever you did on the transform space to the original space. Then only all of this process makes sense. And we have been able to prove that this transform is basically invertible, where this inverse is given by this expression, and it again utilizes the idea of Jordan decomposition. Okay, so that's it for the definitions, but our transform is helpful only if it has some helpful and nice properties. So for this transform, we have what we call as the composition result. I'm not getting into that, but I can just show you one simple example, which is translation. Here in the pictures, you can see that the translation on translation in the signal space that happened on the along the x-axis is basically reflected along the y-axis in the transform space. So this transform takes translations to translations, but an x translation is going to a y translation. Okay, and utilizing this composition property, we are now going to get into the most interesting thing that we got from this transform, which was which led to classification, which is the convexification result here. So first of all, how are we generating classes that we want to separate? So for that, we have something called as this algebraic generative model. So basically, we are given a parent measure. Let's call this mu the parent measure. Given a parent measure, we are generating this algebraic, this whole set, the algebraic generative model, by action of a group of strictly increasing surjections on this parent measure. Okay, so all that we are seeing in this set is coming from action of this H group on this CDF. And the convexification result says that as long as this group H is convex, the corresponding set in the transform space would be convex. Okay. And once we have convexity and we have a nice structure for the space, we were able to prove that it is actually the transform space is actually a metric space. We have utilizing Hahn-Banach separation, we can easily separate classes into because of convexity, we can easily separate classes using strict linear separations, and that is what we have as our linear separability result. Just for the conclusion, I have a simple nice example to show you. So we fabricated this data where we have three signals. We picked up these three signals. And we generated their algebraic generative models or the classes using random translations and dilations. Okay. And we took around 1,000 samples of each of these. And we implemented all of this in Python and used Python-based techniques to look at the separation result. Basically, we used LDA method for the separation. And this is what we got. So we can see that in the signal space, we have data that is all jumbled up, while in the transform space, we have a nice, not a perfect, but a very comparatively very, very nice separation that is happening. And that is basically ensured because of that convexification that we were able to get in the transform space. Yeah, so I guess that's it from my side. The paper that I presented here is available here. You guys can take a look at it. And yeah, thank you so much. Any questions?
Hi. I have one. Hi, mm-hmm. Is there any way that we can transform? Because in when you think about the machine learning and deep learning, we can see it as a deep neural net is a combination of the affine functions and a nonlinear function.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think like that, but yes, affine functions, we can do something based on the matrices and vectors and all these things. For the nonlinear functions, yes, we have to use the gradient descent and all these techniques. Is there any way that we could convert this nonlinear function into the linear function? Have you gone that far?
No, not yet. Yeah, we are basically looking at more properties and more applications of this transform right now. Okay. But I think what you propose is an interesting idea, and we can definitely look at it. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.